High energy anthemic rock songs define the 80s. Guitar solo, stage explosions, sex, drugs, and rock and roll were all the rage on the Sunset Strip and beyond. However, included in these bands' repertoire were songs that showcased a more emotional side of their music. So we're turning down the amps and looking at the softer side of our favorite rock icons on this Valentine's Day episode. And we want them dead or alive. You know, nobody probably wants me singing in those openings, but that's okay. No. Hello and welcome to Totally 80s and 90s Recall. This is a podcast where we'll take a look at everything the memorable decades of the 1980s and 90s had to offer, from music and movies to television and pop culture. If you're new to the show, we're so excited that you found us, and we promise you're going to have an awesome time. And for our returning listeners and subscribers, it's great to have you back. I am one of your hosts, David, joined by a man who, just like a dozen roses, has many thorns. And although we both sit close together in the studio every week, we feel miles apart inside. My friend and yours, Rob.
Well, that's a fitting intro. That's a good, what do they say? It's a segue.
Segue, yeah. Beautiful.
So with the season of love upon us.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, it's coming. Dave and I want to take a minute before today's episode to tell our listeners how much we love them.
We do.
That's right. I said it.
We said it.
We love our fans.
We love them.
So Dave and I want all of you out there to know we can't fight this feeling any longer. And yet we're still afraid to let it flow. What started out as friendship has grown stronger. Dave and I only wish we had the strength to let it show. We tell ourselves that we can't hold out forever. We said there is no reason for our fear because we feel so secure when we're together.
We do.
You give our life direction, you make everything so clear, and even as we wander, we're keeping you in sight. You're a candle in the window on a cold, dark winter's night, and we're getting closer than we ever thought we might. Our life has been such a whirlwind since we met all of you. We've been running around in circles in our minds because you take us to the places that alone we'd never find.
Never.
If you walk away from today's episode with nothing, we hope you hear this. We can't fight this feeling anymore. We've forgotten what we've started fighting for. It's time to bring this ship into the shore and throw away the oars forever. And if we've have to crawl upon the floor, come crashing through your door, just know we can't fight this feeling anymore.
Can't do it. There you go. I love that opening.
Yeah.
That's great. We haven't had them on the show yet, so... The day they make their debut, that's going to be a good day.
That's right.
Because I love them.
Yeah.
So, are you? all right. Well, you mentioned it, but as of the recording of this episode and its debut, actually,
yeah.
Valentine's Day is a week out.
Oh, boy.
All right. This debut is about a week ahead. And so this gets you ready. We're going to give you, we're doing some music today. Rob's about to tell us, and it's going to give you a little... something special for this big Valentine's Day that's coming up. Everybody loves Valentine's Day. Well, I think half people like it, half people probably hate it, but that's fine. Yeah. You can still enjoy this.
How do you feel about Valentine's Day? Do you like it?
It's fine.
I mean, it's a day.
In my opinion, it's a made-up holiday to sell cards and candy.
Okay.
So that's probably not a popular opinion, but that's just my opinion.
That's right.
So, I guess it's based on a St. Valentine's thing and stuff like that.
I don't know.
But... Before we share all of our feelings on Valentine's Day, what are we going to be covering in this episode that is going to give them some of that love, Rob?
Well, we've already talked about some of our hair in a previous episode. We talked about some of our favorite hair bands.
Yes.
But today we're going to do our favorite hair metal ballads.
Yes.
So 80s power ballads.
Yes. We focused the first time on our rocking songs, the get up and get you moving songs. These are the more emotional, aka love songs.
And, well, it was 80s?
Yeah.
80s or 90s?
Some of it went into the first year or two of the 90s.
Good.
You can float in on that.
Okay.
I would say that the majority of the power ballads were born and were in the 80s.
Okay.
But there were a couple bands that bled over.
Okay. I have a few that get early 90s.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
We won't throw you out for that, Rob. Okay. All right. And you know what?
I tried to play by the rules.
At this point, we fully expect it. So it's fine. So, you know,
I really do try to play by the rule.
No, you don't.
I just don't always read these.
Don't let the Robsters down. They've come to expect you not. They want you to color outside the lines. That's what they're looking forward to. You know what's interesting about these rock bands? I was doing all the research for the show, finding my songs. Mm-hmm. I was watching a ton of videos. Mm-hmm. And I think I've said it on the podcast before, but I'm a big sneaker guy. Like, I like sneakers. Uh-huh. So I'm into Jordans. Yeah, yeah, yeah. A lot of the Jordans from when I was younger. It's good memories.
What do they call you? Sneakerhead?
I don't think anyone calls me that personally, but it is a term people use now. But I got tons. You know, I've gotten some Kobe's now. I got Yeezys. So I got a lot of shoes.
Yeah.
My wife thinks it's a bad habit, but I like doing it. So I've got all these shoes. But what I came...
You could be doing drugs.
That so could be. That's much worse.
All right.
About the same... I think you'd spend about the same amount of money, though. So, yeah. No. But how this wraps around is I was watching all these videos. And you got all these rockers, and they got the hair. Mm-hmm. They got jean jackets. Or they're wearing a lot of spandex. Mm-hmm. Or jeans. Or, mm-hmm. like... To be fair, a lot of these 80s hair bands wore some weird clothes. Mm-hmm. But then they would have these pictures and things on stage. I'd see them. They're wearing sneakers. Like, I saw Jordans.
That's true.
I saw one guy was wearing a pair of those Andre Agassi Air Maxes. I saw Bo Jackson's trainers on these hair band rockers. So apparently, maybe they started some sort of sneaker culture.
Oh.
You think all these guys are 50, 60 years old now, and they're still wearing
And they'd have the big sneakers. The tongues hanging out.
Yeah, the tongues are hanging out. Yeah. But literally, a guy was wearing like Jordan 4s with the tongues hanging out. And another guy next to him had big basketball shoes on.
Don't I remember one of the videos for Bon Jovi? He's wearing like spandex with
shoes.
With tennis shoes.
Well, like some kind of sneakers.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I found it very interesting that all these hairband guys have the same affinity for sneakers that I do.
Wow.
So, but back to the power ballads.
Yeah, sorry.
So, no, but that I took us sideways. Yeah, I just found it interesting when I looked at all the sneaker stuff. Yeah. Nobody else might find it interesting, but I found it interesting.
You might speak to this. I don't know. I looked up the definition of a ballad.
Yeah, I have that too.
Do you have it?
Well, I have some sort of we're going to talk about it.
Go for it.
Well, I was going to ask you, and this. You didn't give me a chance to segue.
Yeah, sorry.
You're very excited today.
Yeah, I am.
You know, because I was going to say rock power ballads were a big deal in the 80s, which is what we're covering today. Yeah. And I was going to say, why do you think they were so popular?
Oh, my gosh. Why do we think they were so popular? I don't know.
You don't know?
No. But, man, they were everywhere.
Some of these songs were literally these bands'
most popular
song ever.
Yeah.
So why were they so popular? Why do you think?
Man, I'm trying to think of why would people have wanted that in the 80s and 90s.
Well, hold on to your definition. I just have a little here's what I found, right? So originally ballads were added to the albums as kind of a bridge between the high-speed wailing rock songs, sort of a way to allow the listeners to take a breath.
Mm-hmm.
Like you're listening to the whole album. Mm-hmm. But then they started being requested, particularly by female fans and listeners that were not typical hard rock fans because it was more accessible and it was more radio friendly.
Yeah.
So it became a portal to gain those listeners through that. And they had really catchy hooks and then MTV really liked them because again, they had the catchy hooks.
Yeah.
And then of course they started making the big videos with a lot of color, a lot of pop, a lot of all this. And it just shot those bands' popularity up and basically wrote a script for all these bands on what you could do. So by the end of the 80s, as we said, many of these were known more for their ballads than some of their rock songs.
Yeah.
Some of the bands. And I'll admit they feel cheesy, silly, but they're good, memorable. And I'm sure some good loving was made to many of these songs.
Yeah. Well, and
as weird as that sounds,
in our previous one, we talked about, you know, there were a lot of prom songs and a lot of, you know,
we got that. We're going to have a lot of that today.
A lot of wedding songs.
And so what was your definition?
Oh, it just says, a ballad is a slow, sentimental or romantic song.
It is. It
can also be a poem or song narrating a story in short stanzas.
Nice. Yeah. That's a true definition. That's like a rock.
A slow,
you went on like a music site and found that definition.
Yeah. A slow, sentimental, or romantic song.
That feels like if you were like a professor of music arts and you're like, all right, students, listen up. This is a ballad. And here's your homework. I want you to go home tonight and write me a ballad.
Yeah, I want you to write a poem or song narrating a story in short stanzas.
Well, I remember ballads just because it felt like those were the ones that got on TV more.
Mm-hmm.
And it, like I said, there was a formula to them. The videos were kind of all the same. There were just a lot of markers, you know, the acoustic guitar, sunglasses in the dark. I love when they do all the videos would go into slow motion, you know, they set all these things up perfectly. Yeah. I thought they were fun. They're great. Mm-hmm. You look back on them now, if you look at the composition of a song as a music critic, are these good songs? Not all of them.
Yeah.
But if I look back at them from nostalgia, fun, and just good mm-hmm. memories, I love all these songs.
Yeah.
And particularly the ones that I chose today.
Yeah. No, the ones I picked, I like too. And
I still listen to them.
And, you know, there's that, you've said it, and we've referenced it several times, but you've heard the phrase lovable garbage.
Lovable garbage.
You know, and I think that
that's some of this.
And some of these
is not lovable garbage. Some of this is awesome.
And some of it's like garbage. A guilty pleasure type thing where you're you don't want to like it, but you can't help it.
You can't help yourself.
You like it.
Yeah, I might have a couple of those. Yeah. You know, you'd be like, he really likes that song? And I'd be like,
I do.
You're damn right.
That's right.
I will rock. Yeah. I will rock out to that. It'll be like, at my funeral, I want that song played.
Yeah.
So. Yeah. But I think they just gained popularity because, well, the ladies liked them.
Yeah.
And when you hook the ladies in, then the guys will follow. So then even if you were a hard rocker and you thought, oh, these are silly, but the girls all liked them, you'd be like, oh, yeah, I guess I don't mind that one. You know what I mean?
Well, you said the radio-friendly part of it, I think, is a really important part.
It is.
Especially, you know, 80s was, you know, we've mentioned the importance of the video that came about. And so now you have a visual element.
Yeah.
And you can pull in the ladies and maybe even parents would go, they're not that bad.
They're not that bad.
That's a nice song. And then
you hear Motley Crue play their ballad.
And then you hear girls, girls, girls.
Yeah. And you're like, what happened? Yeah. They're such nice boys.
What are you listening to?
Tommy Lee looks like a nice guy.
Yeah.
you haven't seen his sex tape. He drives a boat with his. All right, but we're going to. We're going to remember yesterday, walking hand in hand, and we want to hear you say we remember our favorite 80s power ballads. All right, fans, take a second before we start to slowly bang our heads and hit the subscribe button for Totally 80s and 90s Recall if you haven't done so already, and that will ensure you never miss an episode of this awesome podcast. And to show the love this close to Valentine's Day, share it with a friend who longs for the 80s and 90s as much as you do, and Rob and I will ensure we keep all of you coming back for more. So that's our job.
That's our job.
Our job is to keep you coming back for more.
And I hope we do. I think we do.
Sometimes.
I don't think we turn anybody away.
I'm sure someone's turned away.
No.
Let's not be that confident in ourselves. We probably have a 98% success rate.
Hey, I'll take 98%.
There's 2% out there. They're like, what are these fools talking about? They listen to it.
I can't.
What is going on?
I did have some the other day. I was showing them our podcast, and they went. They were looking at the times. They went. An hour?
I know. Someone asked me that. Like, what do you talk about for an hour? Listen to it. And then I got a message back and they're like, oh, it went by really fast.
Yeah.
I'm like, well, I mean, that's what we're doing.
We're not bad to listen to.
We're more famous than you think we are. We work in the same school district now.
We do.
I was at your school a couple Fridays ago and one of your teachers was in the hallway. And I don't know if she's listening to this, but she's being highlighted now. She said, aren't you the guys that work on the podcast? And I said, we should have taken a picture with her.
We missed our opportunity.
She seemed very excited that we were together in the same place.
Yeah.
So
You're that podcast guy.
You're that podcast guy. Yeah. So.
Well, that's where you're called the voice.
I am the voice.
He's the voice. Is he the voice?
I am the voice. So, all right. Well, the voice says it's time, Rob. Let's dig into some feelings. Slow things down a little and give the folks some great songs they can play this most romantic day of the year to woo that special person.
Woo.
And with that, Rob, you know what to do.
Oh, it's my number 7.
Oh, my goodness.
Right?
It is.
Oh, my gosh.
Here we go. It's almost like you know the rhythm of the show.
Wow.
Nice. I slipped down from the top. That's life.
I'm not a huge Motley Crue fan.
Well, I don't like to hear that at all.
But
everyone's a huge Motley Crue fan. Without you. Literally the funnest. Literally the funnest band of the 80s. Not a big fan.
Mm. Without you, woman.
My life.
So that is without you.
That is sensitive.
Yeah. Oh, hey, we haven't talked about it. How many do you think we'll have crossover?
I am a little.
You're worried.
I'm a little wary today that we're going to have multiple. I know people tune in here. They want to hear like 20 individual songs, and that's the playlist for them. But I just think there's a multitude of like iconic 80s ballads that I feel like they're going to fall in there. So I'm going to go. I'm going to go five.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I think.
Okay.
And we found before, and I think we found this out on our hairband rock episode, that our experiences in the hairband arena are somewhat similar.
Oh, yeah.
So we kind of had some of the same stuff. Yeah. I mean, we'd sit in the same room and headbang together, so, right?
No, we didn't.
Okay, we didn't.
We didn't at all.
We did, folks. Don't let him lie to you. It was a good time.
Remember, I was busy in my room with the
Tony Braxton.
John Lee Hooker.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Lights down.
And the Boys to Men poster and the Tony Braxton magazine under your mattress. All the things in your room. People are going to think about your room now and be like, what is going on in that place? Anyway, back to your song.
Anyway, so this is a, all of these have been defined as, and I think I made sure to put all of them. They were defined as a power ballad.
Of course.
Motley Crue, released in 89 on their album, Dr. Feelgood.
Great album.
It's said to be about Tommy Lee's relationship with Heather Locklear.
Very good.
Yeah. Reached number 8 on the Billboard Hot 100. Loudwire.com ranked it number 13 on their list of the top 30 hairband albums.
Nice.
And it became one of the era's biggest selling records. We've already talked about Kickstart My Heart.
That has been mentioned
on this one of our episodes.
Yes.
And then Don't Go Away Mad, Just Go Away.
That's a great title.
And I remember you singing that song when we were a kid.
That's wonderful.
Don't go away, man.
Yeah. Well, it's really good.
Just Go Away.
I'm surprised you didn't have that one.
Yeah. It was on my cutting room. With lyrics like, without you in my life, I'd slowly wilt and die.
That's emotional.
But with you by my side, you're the reason I'm alive. But with you in my life, you're the reason why I'm alive. He says it 2 times.
Yeah.
But without you. Without you.
Without you.
Yeah,
you know what I found with those lyrics, and we're going to find out as I go through mine, a lot of these had some very motivational and inspirational like messages tied into these songs.
Yeah. Later in the song, he says, without you, a sailor lost at sea.
That's good imagery.
Oh, come on.
Come on.
Yeah, the world comes down on me.
Oof, I like it.
I wonder who wrote it. I didn't do enough research on who wrote it.
I'm sure Vince wrote it. I don't know. I don't think Vince wrote anything. Didn't Nikki Sixx write some of their songs?
I don't know.
When he was alive, at least. So, all right. Well, that's a good start. And, you know, in our prediction of 5 crossovers that I had, I don't have that song.
Okay.
So we're off to a good start.
I think we're going to be better than you think.
All right.
I know you.
We'll see.
You're worried.
We'll see what happens. So, well, my number 7 is a little heartfelt tune by a band from the UK who seem to have a lot of questions about the weird feelings going on inside of their body. See the questions? He doesn't know what's going on.
I have another song on this count that has a lot of questions.
I like questions.
Oh, yeah. Is this love? Is this the love I've been searching for?
Or am I dreaming?
Am I dreaming?
It's a lot of questions. He doesn't know what's going on.
Wow.
He doesn't know what's happening, but he knows it has a hold on him.
That's really
good. So that's pretty good. Well, this was released.
He's a grown man. He should know what's going on.
I said this was released. Sorry, folks. If you don't know, this is called Is This Love by Whitesnake. Great name, by the way. A lot of these bands have great names.
Yeah.
This was released in May of 1987 in the UK and then October of 87 in the United States. This was the second single released after their mega hit, Here I Go Again, 87, because it was released previously. Mm-hmm. It went to number 2 on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100, number 9 on the U.K. charts, and was the 17th best-selling single for all of 1988, according to Billboard. It has been confirmed by the lead singer, David Coverdale, great hair, that the song was written for Tina Turner. However, after David Geffen, president of Geffen Records, heard it, he told Coverdale to keep it and record it for Whitesnake. So maybe there's a reason Geffen was so successful in the music biz. He had an ear for the things that needed to be heard, because that wouldn't have sounded right with Tina Turner. Sorry, yeah, Tina.
That would.
Tawny's back for this video as well. Oh. But alas, no Jaguar spreads in this one.
Oh.
Just her dancing around half naked in a loft apartment. Oh.
That's all right.
And a shot of Coverdale in an empty hallway, snapping his fingers with one foot on the wall during the guitar solo. Chef's kiss. Very artistic,
Rob.
Is it
with his back to the wall?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, that's good.
Fun fact, Is This Love is played more often on adult contemporary stations than Here I Go Again, despite it being the band's second most popular song. So do you think, as hair glam rockers in the 80s, Whitesnake envisioned themselves landing on adult contemporary radio with the likes of Chicago, Michael Bolton, and more later in life?
Oh, sure.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
When they wrote that song, they're like, that's us. We're going right there.
That wanker.
This is one of those now.
Michael Bolton.
When you're our age, you know, 47 to 50, you're like looking at a cantaloupe. Is this good? Oh, is this the? And you hear it in the rafters of the supermarkets. Oh,
that's
funny. You know, you're in, you know, HEB or, you know, wherever you're going shopping, Fred Meyer, and you're up there and you're like, you know, is this love?
Yeah.
Rocking out, that's buying good. Grapefruit. Yeah. That's what you got to do, buying cantaloupe, whatever that fruit you're trying to find.
The price of avocado these days.
It's gone through the roof.
Is that Whitesnake?
Yeah. It used to be a nickel.
I remember when tomatoes.
Avocados were a nickel.
Oh, man.
I remember when my mom used to eat grapes for free out of the store, and I now realize she was just stealing grapes. Yeah. So
my dad's thing is, it's going to hell in a handbasket.
I got to test these grapes before we take them home.
World's going to hell in a handbasket. All right.
All right. That's really good. Time for your number six.
All right. I'm really excited about this. I'd forgotten about this.
Be excited.
Here we go.
Slaughter, baby. I looked at this.
Mm.
I also don't have this.
Oh.
But I do like this song a lot. That guy just sings in that pitch the whole time. I
love his voice.
How does he do that?
Yeah, he never...
No male should do that.
Ooh.
I'd say maybe the second, third highest pitch guy. That guy, don't know his name. The lead singer of Firehouse and Sebastian Bach.
Oh, so good.
So good.
So this is Slaughter.
Slaughter.
Fly to the Angel.
That's a great title.
I know.
Fly to the Angel.
The title of their album is even better. Stick It to You. That's the name of the album.
Very clever.
They're considered an American glam band.
They are definitely that.
This is released July 1990.
Yes.
Reached number 19 on the Billboard Hot 100. Loudwire.com ranked the album number 26 in their list of the top 30 hair bands. It went double platinum. Their song Up All Night, also mentioned on another episode, was
our other hair band episode.
Yeah. And I think we both picked that one.
We love Slaughter.
Yeah. Yeah, because what was it? You can't spell.
Can't spell.
Slaughter without laughter.
Slaughter without laughter.
No, there it is.
Can't spell slaughter without laughter.
Yep. Here's some lyrics. Pictures of you, oh, they're still on my mind. You had this smile that could light up the world. Now it rains, it seems the sun never shines. And I drive down this lonely, lonely road. Oh, I got this feeling, girl, I can't let you go. Because now you're going to fly high. Fly to the angel. Heaven awaits your heart and flowers bloom in your name.
I like it.
Mark Slaughter was asked about the song, to which he stated, quote, that song was written about a girlfriend who I went to high school with. I remember I came back from touring and couldn't get a hold of her. So I asked a friend and he told me he hadn't seen her. The next thing I know, he calls me back with the news that she had passed away and the funeral was the next day.
Did he get there?
I don't know. It was one of those surreal moments. I went to her funeral. Oh, there you go. Oh,
there it is.
And it inspired me to write a song about letting go. There's a real sense of composure in going through those life events that I'm always very conscious of in my music. Seeing what it does for other people is why I continue to write.
Yes.
There you go.
Do you think his last name is actually Slaughter?
Mark Slaughter is his name. Right. Yeah.
You know, in the future, sidebar.
Yeah.
Has nothing to do with our countdown.
Yeah.
This, we need to move this on our days where we're.
I know.
It's just this obstruction.
Yeah, they can't see.
I can't see your eyeballs at all. So.
We can. They can't see it.
They can't.
You and
see
I are.
It.
Yeah, we're there's just, a camera right
in front of us. So
anyway,
it's quite distracting.
Yeah,
but that's okay. Right. That's
day,
a good one.
One
you
day.
Are two for two.
Okay.
You know, in our last episode, you went a little haywire, but today feels like you're right on track so far. Fans are loving it. All right. Well, my number six lets those hard rocking folks out there know don't take anything for granted, especially Rob, the one that you love.
I do not know this. It's Cinderella.
Cinderella. You'll know it when the chorus hits in a second. You should know it. If you don't, I'll be disappointed.
Nobody's fool.
Difference. Hear that bridge.
What you got until it's gone. Yeah, love it. Good song.
Oh, yeah. That's great.
I do not have this, by the way.
That's great. We're 2 for 2.
Nice.
As we get higher, I imagine this is going to go the other way.
Yeah.
But that's fine. So I think right before we came on air today, I think you said Tom Kiefer's birthday.
Yeah.
Right?
Today.
As we record, he's
63 or something. 63. Yeah, okay. He's in his 60s.
Well, happy birthday. And I know you're listening, Tom. So feel free to call us. We'll get you on the show.
He's like, oh, sorry, guys. I got to catch those guys over at Total 80's.
So he's nice recall. You think he talks like that?
Yeah.
The way he sings doesn't tell me he talks like that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, what a great band name, Cinderella. Nothing says hard rock more than a Disney movie, right, Rob?
Yeah.
This song hit the airwaves in August of 1988. Great month. It shot to number 12 in the U.S. Hot 100. Not a ton of success anywhere else that I could find. In fact, it was only 145 in Australia. So they definitely just wanted this song gone, apparently. So despite previous success, this was the band's most successful single. So we talked about that earlier, and here it is. The lead singer, apologize for that, folks. My mouth got stuck. The lead singer, Tom Kiefer, has one of those perfect hair metal voices for ballads like this. He's raspy. It's very emotional. Like, you feel it in your bones. The video is quite the event. The band's playing on a beach and a desert at the same time. Oh. Good job, boys. I don't know how you did that. And look, about this song. I want to set a stage for you. Okay. This is what I imagine.
Okay.
It's 1988.
88.
Some poor girl. She's in her bedroom.
Uh-huh.
Boyfriend just broke up with her.
Oh.
She's got this song on a loop. She's crying.
Yeah.
You know, listening to this over and over. And then her mom comes in, tells her, hey, why don't you listen to another song? And there's going to be other guys. Yeah. You don't understand it, Mom. And kicks her out of the room.
Uh-huh.
And her mom's just shaking her head. That sounds like an 80s movie right there. We should make that. That sounds good. Just crying in her room, mascara running, and just hit play again. Yeah. Rewind it. Boom. Tom Kiefer. Tell me how bad. My 10th grade boyfriend broke up with me.
Well, if this podcast thing doesn't work out, you can
make movies.
You can be
a
video producer.
Mom comes in. You'll be okay, hon. There's going to be other boys. You don't go. Get out, Mom.
There'll be other boys.
Cinderella's the only one that understands me.
I always he did the headband. He always had a headband.
He was a big headband guy. Yeah. So what I love the most about that video is they are rocking out.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing's plugged in. They're in the middle of a desert.
Oh, yeah.
There's no amps. There's no chords. Yeah,
nobody catches on.
Those guitars are just, those are the best sounding acoustic guitars I've ever heard in my life. So and the drums, you can just hear them clear as day.
At least in November rain, when Slash is playing at the church.
Yes.
There's a chord. I believe there's a chord.
But it's not going to anything.
No. Yeah, anyway.
Again. So they're better with their instruments than we were.
Yeah.
So.
Anyway. All right.
But my instrument was a trumpet, so not nearly as cool as Slash.
You played the trumpet?
I did.
Oh, wow. I think we've talked about that.
Through junior high.
Yeah, I played the violin for like 2 weeks.
You seem like a violiner.
Yeah. All right. And my dad was like, take it back.
Get rid of that
thing. You're not practicing. I'm not playing rent on that.
You wanted to be Yo-Yo Ma.
Yeah, I guess.
All right.
All right. My number five?
Number five.
Okay. This one?
Uh-oh.
Anyway.
Ah, very good, Rob.
Oh, you like it?
Mr. Big.
I thought maybe you'd say, like...
No, I love this song.
This would be on people's worst list.
Hell no. Who doesn't love this song?
Feel it too.
I like his open button-up shirt in the video, too. Yeah. Like, unnecessary, but it's good.
Yeah.
This is like 91 or 92, though.
91.
So they're really... Like, this is the last breath... Oh, that you could have got this song in.
I think I say that in my notes.
Yeah. This is your last moment.
Yeah.
You record this 6 months later than you did. That's not getting on the radio. No.
Yeah. I think so this is Mr. Big, 1991. The song is called To Be With You. It reached number one on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100. It topped the charts in 15 countries.
That is amazing.
Yeah. Frontman Eric Martin said the lyrics were inspired by a girl he knew when he was younger. Quote, this girl had a lot of boyfriends who treated her like shit. I wanted to be the knight in shining armor, wanted to be with her. She wasn't having it.
The ladies like the bad boys.
It never came to play. So he wanted to be with her. She never saw him.
He got friend zoned.
Yeah,
that's what happened.
That's the worst. Yep, I was in the friend zone a long time. Yeah, my yearbook is full of, you're a great guy.
Great guy.
Yeah.
You stay nice.
Yeah.
I had one time. It literally said, you are a great friend.
Yeah.
Throw that as far as that's I can get it. Yeah, that's what I wanted.
I got yearbooks full of that.
Terrible.
So here's the chorus. I'm the one who wants to be with you. Deep inside, I hope you feel it too. Waited on a line of greens and blues. Yeah, just to be the next to be with you. I don't know.
The greens and blues is a throw in, just a rhyme, I think.
I don't know.
Because I don't know what that means.
I was trying to think what the, I kind of pondered symbolism. That. Like, what is the symbolism? I don't know. It's been described as a campfire sing-along ballad, harmonious strummer, sing-along single, and a simple little ballad.
It's good.
VH1.com listed To Be With You in their article entitled, five hair metal ballads inspired by / ripped off from Extreme's More Than Words.
Oh, okay. I don't think those sound that much.
Every
the
bad
same.
Boy rocker has a sensitive side, especially after a power ballad goes platinum.
Of
that
course.
That was the subtitle of that article.
That's that formula we talk about.
Yeah. Speaking about this song, the article says you might also fall hopelessly in love with whoever happens to be closest to you in the room should you try that. So be careful. Jonathan Bernstein from Spin wrote, quote, in a year sadly lacking in palpable power ballads, these third raters rode their Trojan horse to pole position with one of the always spinless genre's most puny entries, To Be With You.
Someone sounds angry about ballads.
Jonathan Bernstein from Spin was having a bad day.
Just take a deep breath and enjoy the song. It's not that big a deal, man. Yeah,
he did not like it.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Maybe he was too busy listening to John Lee Hooker. And then he just couldn't take the Mr. Big.
Yeah, I didn't say. You got to be careful, John Lee Hooker.
Got to be careful.
Bring some emotion.
By the way, we were complaining a few minutes ago that, about the friend zone thing, that you and I had girls willingly write in there that we were nice people and were mad about it. So maybe we should reevaluate what we're getting angry about. They could have not signed anything.
That sucks.
Yeah, so.
You think I'm nice?
I actually preferred getting the you're nice or you're a friend than the just have a great summer, because that's just the ultimate – yeah, I'll sign it because I don't want to hurt your feelings.
Well, and then on the flip side, to be honest, I looked back and I had phone numbers.
I did too.
Never called them.
Didn't either.
So that's on
me. I told my wife that once and
that's my fault.
She goes, you know, a girl doesn't write the phone number in there.
I know that now.
If they don't want you to call it. And I was like,
hindsight being
weird.
2020,
yeah.
I look back now.
I had like my sophomore year, I had like six phone numbers in there. Yeah. Did I call any of them? No, I did not.
Yeah, that's on me.
So,
yeah.
Man, I'm a weirdo. All right. Anyway,
I go, I had her number.
Now, but when I was 20, I just six numbers, I'd have been like, hell yeah, that's what I'm doing now, man. I'm just flipping the ladies. All right. That's a good song, too. You are three for three today.
Nice.
I am loving it. And another song that I do not have.
Oh, wow.
So we're on fire. All right. My number five is a song that tells the one that means the most to you exactly how they make you feel.
I don't have it.
I love it. This is like iconic. Oh.
This is a good playlist.
Oh, it's great. Listen to the words. This is that inspiration we talk about.
What's on that? Like a ray of hope.
Oh, yeah. Ray of light.
Ray of light?
Oh.
Very positive.
Very positive.
Live. Oh.
I like his background singers.
That's really good.
I think they're doing a good job back there.
No, so. Every now and then we put together a playlist and just make. I get like butterflies
in your stomach. Yeah.
And I like this one.
You know why you got butterflies in your stomach? Actually, because you just said on the previous song, Mr. Big, we played it in the room, so I guess we fell in love now. Right? That's what the reviewers said. So maybe that's the butterflies.
I don't know.
I gave you butterflies.
You give me
all right.
Make me feel all funny.
This is When I See You Smile by Bad English. I just realized for our fans paying attention, on the last song, I got so excited, we sidetracked and I talked. The name of the last song I played was Don't Know What You Got, parentheticals, Till It's Gone by Cinderella.
Oh, okay.
And I didn't announce that.
That's all right.
Yeah. And now I'm on to When I See You Smile by Bad English.
My wife will appreciate that.
Yes, I know.
Because she says that sometimes when she's putting on her makeup and we skip and we jump. And then she goes, I don't know.
Yeah. We assume people should know who that is. But
we apologize.
Well, this song was written by Diane Warren, who has written so many hit songs. And I think, Rob, you've mentioned her before about the amount of songs in the 80s and 90s.
Yeah.
Like Armageddon and all these other songs.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. This was released August of 1989 in maybe the heyday of hair metal. 89. You could look at that. A lot of these songs came from 89, at least on my list. This was a number one hit on the Billboard Hot 100 and number one in Canada. The song is certified platinum in Australia and was the 21st best-selling single down under in 1990. Like Cinderella, this is the band's most popular and successful single. Bad English is actually a supergroup composed of the lead singer John Waite, famous for the song Missing You. I'm missing you.
Yeah.
So that's him. And then several members of Journey make up the background band.
I did not know
that. So it's like a super group.
Wow. Yeah.
The band was only together a little over a year before the Journey members wanted to go back to Journey.
Yeah.
That may be a good move. Yeah. I'm not sure. I chose this song because it just exudes 80s ballad glam rock. As soon as you hear it, it takes you right back to the late 80s with the hair, the lighters at the concerts, cheesy MTV videos, all of it. And how inspirational. Sometimes I want to... give up. I want to give in. I want to quit the fight. But then I see you and everything's all right.
That's right. Oh,
pure poetry, right? Yeah. And how much of a heart stopper is saying to your lady, when I see you smile, I can face the world. You know, I can do anything. I mean, come on. You say that to your lovely lady or your lovely man or whoever it is you're expressing that to. Yeah. I think they just toss their drawers at you. Here you go. Just take those. Those are for you.
Oh no! Have you? You're gonna use this on? Does this work in your house?
What's that?
Like if you were to walk out and go, "Hey, I'm heading to work."
Oh yeah.
But and I'm about ready. It's gonna be a tough day. But when I see your smile, I can face the world.
Yep. I get a kiss goodbye. I get a single tear.
Oh.
And then
she throws her drawers at you.
Yep. They go in the pocket. See you when you get home. My wife's going to hate that, but it is what it is.
And my wife's going to be mad that I initiated that.
You did.
So I did. So, I'm sorry.
We try not to wade into the gross pool too often, but I'm just stating facts here. That's not gross or anything. No. It's just a fact.
You can't help it.
You know.
That's a fact.
You know, for those, you know, turn away if you don't like this, but that is a certified panty dropper.
I was going to say
there
that.
There you go.
And I didn't want to.
I did it.
To,
but I will take, it. I'll take the hit for you.
All right.
So you can say, hon, I told him, you know. But we're talking about hair metal here. We're talking about hair metal here, so I think terms like that are going to happen.
Yeah.
That's just what. There's nothing we can do.
Yeah, we're keeping it clean. So
we are.
All right. Well, I have bad news.
Is it the same song?
No.
Oh, but
we
okay.
have a crossover.
Oh,
it's our first one.
It was coming.
So, yeah. So.
Ah, yes. I mean, it seems like a song you have to have, right?
Yeah.
That's one. I called five.
I don't think we're going to have five.
All right.
Because I'm looking at the rest of mine, and I just don't see it.
But all right.
Our number ones could be the same.
I'm going to say no, based on what you've already played.
Oh.
But we'll see what happens.
All right.
And I think you're going to be surprised by my number one.
Yeah, really?
I don't think you're going to think that would have been my choice.
Oh, gosh. This is, like you said, is this Love by Whitesnake? Nothing new to report, and I won't. Go on a
come on report it.
But in 2015, Classic Rock magazine ranked it as its seventh greatest power ballad on their list of 40.
Nice.
So they really like this one. Then I just have
wouldn't like it.
Is this love that I'm feeling? Is this the love that I've been searching for? Is this love, or am I dreaming?
Told you lots of questions.
This must be love.
Yep.
Because it's really got a hold on me. A hold on me.
Yeah.
So anyway, great lyrics.
David Coverdale. He's got a lot of questions.
Yeah. You know, and I was going to say, earlier you talked about the lead singer of Cinderella.
Mm.
And you said, oh, such a great voice.
Oh, yeah.
Unfortunately, I think some of these voices have not aged. You look at like what's happened with Motley Crue.
They're not as good anymore.
But
they were great then.
But Coverdale's, though.
Still good.
I think he's gone, isn't he? I think he passed away.
Is he? Okay.
I think. I don't know.
I'm not sure.
I do not know. But he's one that I think his voice would have. I think he could have held that.
You know,
some of them were pretty.
Well, what you can do is so we can confirm for our fans because we like to be good. Yeah. Maybe you can get them to give you an answer while I'm playing my next one.
Yeah.
Was that everything you had on?
Yeah, that's all I got.
All right. Well, I know my number four song was blaring in the backseat of a lot of sweaty cars, and is probably responsible for some of our listeners that were born in late 1990 to 1991.
I don't have it.
That's your own fault. This is fantastic.
It's good.
There's a lot of babies made to this song.
This is baby making music.
I think on the next bridge you get a good sample of Sebastian's voice. It's fantastic.
Yeah, I like where he holds that.
Mm. It's really good. I could listen to that song all day. All right. That was I Remember by, of course, Skid Row. This song has been featured previously on a Billboard episode from 1990, and I don't usually repeat songs, as I like to give lots of different samples to the fans, but I couldn't, in good conscience, have this list without this song. Just couldn't do it. Sebastian Bach might be the best singer of all these songs on the list of all these bands. The best pure singer, I think. And the passion he tosses into this is pretty amazing. It's a little cheesy, yes, but it does. It's still absolutely rock. Hell yes. It's awesome. It was released in November of 1989, went to number 6 on the U.S. Hot 100, number 2 in New Zealand. And before releasing the song, the band tested it out in small clubs, to which the song became really popular with women. So at first, the band wasn't sure they wanted to even include the song on the album so as not to be labeled a chick band. Uh-huh. I know chick is not a great term nowadays, but that's what they said. But Sebastian Bach and the label, surprisingly, said, nope, it's got potential. We're including it on the album. And of course, it went crazy. It's described as an explosive power ballad. And I do really like the guitars in this song as well. There's a good guitar solo in the middle. And just to remind everyone who didn't hear our 1990 episode, this was the number one prom song in America in 1990. The song is about a guy who can't let go of the memory of the girl he loves. He is obsessed and cannot sleep or move on with his life. So maybe this sounds like a stalker or a future serial killer. I'm not sure. But fun fact, Sebastian Bach was only 20 years old when he recorded and then the song was released. So, That's more than what I was doing when I was 20. So,
Yeah, it's all a blur. Really.
It's all a blur. Yeah.
I wasn't doing anything cool. I know that. Hey, Kip and the boys got me some data.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
David Coverdale, he's not dead.
Well, David, we apologize for falsely reporting. Yeah, that's going to be on TMZ or something now. Yeah, Rob is going to be faulted for that.
He's 72.
That's good. Wow. Think he can still sing?
He looks good for 72.
All right.
Anyway.
Still got the hair?
He still got the hair. Oh, yeah, it looks good. Tony Katane, sadly. They divorced in 91.
Yeah. Well, I knew she passed away.
Yeah. Oh, anyway. All right. Yeah. So that's, my number three. This is an odd one, but I'm going to pick it.
Oh, okay. Ah, beautiful. Cheap Trick.
Yeah. I didn't know that's who sung it.
I knew
the song, but I didn't know who sung it.
This is fantastic.
You hear it?
Absolutely love it.
And there's some, I have some legitimacy to me not knowing that it was Cheap Trick.
No.
There's some stuff in my notes.
I've always known this was Cheap Trick. This is on every playlist I have. Listen to that.
Mm.
To Lay Your Heart in Hell Upon.
Oh, fire. After all the rain. There you go.
Oh.
All right.
This just reminds me of all these songs. I just feel like I'm... like 13, 12 or 13 again.
Well, I feel like it's a perfect late night and the Power Ballad commercial comes on for the Time Life set. Yeah. So there's a Power Ballad released in 88. It's Cheap Trick. Reached number one on the Billboard Hot 100 in July of 88. It's the band's only number one hit.
Of course.
Lead guitarist Rick Nielsen disliked the song so much on his first hearing that he yanked it from the tape player and ground the cassette beneath his boot heel. The band really didn't like the song, but recorded it because they thought it might give them a hit. Their only hit not co-written by their guitarist, Rick Nielsen, MetalSludge.tv.
Great, great publication.
Named the song number 11 on their list of the top 19 sappiest and greatest power ballads of all time. The chorus goes, "You were the first. You'll be the last. Wherever you go, I'll be with you. Whatever you want, I'll give it to you. Whenever you need someone to lay your heart and head upon, remember, after the fire, after the rain, I will be the flame." Great. It's been described as a lush power ballad, memorable, equal to the band's best ballads, a great melodic rock tune, a radio smash, and a tender ballad.
I love that word, lush.
Yeah. In an interview, Cheap Trick drummer explained, the vice president at Epic told... Oh, you're going to like this.
Oh, I will.
The vice president at Epic told us he had these two songs, and they're both going to go number one.
Number one.
He goes, "We got one for you and one for the group Chicago."
Ooh. What was the Chicago song?
But you can have first choice.
Ooh.
He said, I think the one, the flame, would be good for you guys.
Yeah.
The other one was...
Look Away.
Look Away.
Ah, which was the number one hit.
And it sounded like some girl singing on the demo. No, we really didn't like that song anyway, so sure, we'll do the flame. We're game.
Yeah.
There you go, so...
Everyone won.
Everybody, yeah.
Everybody won.
No, and no losers in that one.
So. There was no losers in that one. That's good. Well, yeah. You are on fire. All right. Well, my number three song needs no introduction at all. Oh. Ooh, that's you, I think, huh? There you go. You just wanted to keep listening to Cheap Trick.
Yes, I did. Oh, Love Bites.
I like the breakdown in the middle if I hit the right part. Nope, not yet. There's a good guitar solo in there somewhere. I like that.
Yeah, in the there's background. Some robotic like it's good. Voices in the back.
Maybe it's the guy with one arm.
So, I don't think so.
The drummer. Well, this, if anybody doesn't know, is Love Bites by Def Leppard. This lands at number three for me, but I may not have listened to any ballad in the 80s more or in my life than this song. I've mentioned our local radio station in Portland, Z100, many times, but they would do a top five at nine every night of the week. I got a lot of songs on tape off that countdown, but this song was number one on that top five for what seemed like six straight months, like every night. And if it wasn't the most popular requested song at that station in 1988, I don't know what else could have been. This is off the Hysteria album, which is probably, outside of Appetite for Destruction, my favorite hard rock slash hair metal album of the 80s. This was obviously number one in the U.S. Billboard Hot 100. But what I'm finding doing the research for this countdown is maybe the rest of the world didn't seem to be as enamored with ballads as the U.S. was, because they didn't chart quite as much. It charted okay in other countries, most notably hitting number one in Canada, number two in New Zealand, but pretty mild success everywhere else. This is Def Leppard's only number one hit single on the Billboard Hot 100, as we said about other ones, and was originally a country ballad when Mutt Lang gave it to the band. But being Def Leppard, they added power guitars, changed the musical arrangement, and voila, 80s hair metal gold. Lyrics are interesting. It says, when you make love, do you look in your mirror? Who do you think of? Does he look like me? So he misses her, but later says, I don't want to touch you too much, baby, because making love to you might drive me crazy.
Oh, yeah.
These are some mixed messages going on here from Joe Elliott. All I know is this. It's probably ballad royalty in the pantheon of this genre of songs and a must add for any playlist like this. Can we even contemplate the amount of proms, homecomings, wedding receptions this has been played at? I don't think you could even put a number on
it. This is your number two.
Number three.
Number three, I mean. Yeah. Wow. Yeah, I...
Because I got two bangers before this one.
Yeah, your two have to be good.
Oh, they're great.
Because I would have thought this would have been higher in here.
Nope, I got two. I got two home runs in front of it.
Wow, you got two in the chamber. I'm ready. Okay. Yeah. My number two.
That's number two.
Is...
Oh, you went with this one. You know, I actually like this better than Every Rose Has Its Thorn. If I do ballads of Poison, I actually, when I was younger, I like Every Rose, but as I got older, I think I like this one a little better.
In every list I found, people said, if you're ranking Poison songs, this always comes up number one.
Unfortunately, I've also read a lot of things about this song where they're like, oh, this is a cop-out, this is cheesy, kind of, you know. Yeah. They said they basically took the success of Every Rose Has Its Thorn and tried to do it again.
Yeah.
But I don't care. I like it.
I like it. Yeah. So this is
although something... I find it rich real quick. I find it rich, and you may explain it, but him talking about the rich are drinking from the golden cup, and then I'm like, you're rich. Yeah. But anyway, that's fine.
Yeah, I think. Well, and that's not to get off topic too much, but when we were doing our last episode, Rage Against Machine gets a lot of flack because they raged against Machine, but then they became part of the Machine.
But the problem you have is that they were really the same. People just didn't realize it.
Yeah.
So the reality is those fans that said they became part of the Machine, they just heard the loud noise and the craziness in the 90s and thought, oh, this is a thrash metal band. Yeah. Go listen to Take the Power Back. Go listen to Killing in the Name and listen to the actual lyrics.
Mm-hmm.
They really haven't changed that much.
Yeah.
All right. You want to hear some crazy lyrics? Go listen to Down Rodeo on Evil Empire.
Yeah.
Go listen to those lyrics.
That's a good album. Something to Believe In by Poison, released in 90. The ballad peaked at number four on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100. It was Poison's last top 10 hit on the Billboard Hot 100. Widely regarded as one of Poison's best songs. The song was dedicated to Bret Michaels' security guard and best friend who had died on Christmas Eve of 89, and also dedicated to Bret's cousin Bob.
Nice.
Who was wounded in Vietnam. It's described as a heartfelt song, genuine, moving, incredible, gives me goosebumps every time. Lyrics. My best friend died a lonely man in some Palm Springs hotel room. I got the call last Christmas Eve, and they told me the news. I tried all night to break down and cry. As the tears rolled down my face, I felt so cold and empty, like a lost soul out of place. And the mirror on the wall sees my smile as it fades again. Yeah, so anyway. The cover art for the single, I thought this was interesting. The cover art for the single depicts a tattoo on Michaels' arm of a cross with the word "something to believe in." The tattoo artist, according to Michaels, had been drinking and spelled "believe" incorrectly, putting the E before the I.
Oh, except after C.
Yeah. In the first season of the reality show Rock of Love, Michaels goes to a tattoo shop where the tattoo artist promptly touches up the tattoo.
Spells it right.
Yeah.
Like, hey, you said that was E. That was Poison's last number one hit. You think, I think on our last episode, you said them and Alice in Chains were partying together.
Yes.
You think they were listening to this as their last
one? I don't know.
Hey, Lane, you want to hear our last number one song?
That's like a surreal image to go. Hey, here's Bret Michaels and the guy hanging out with Lane Staley. That's wrong.
Well, yeah, it doesn't work. Another good one, man. You're on fire over there today. So, yeah. Well, my number two song tells you that life on earth is paradise. As long as you have the one that you love.
What? I don't have this one.
Oh, what?
Nope.
Have you listened to this? I like the background singers.
Yeah, love it.
Here we come. There they are.
No matter what your friends might say.
No matter. Oh, wait. Good part right here. Oh. How about that guitar solo? We don't get to hear all of it, but I promise it wails. All right. Well, this is Heaven.
Cut you off. Sorry, man.
Heaven by Warrant. Warrant just oozes the excess and somewhat formula of glam rock, but Janie Lane could sing for sure. And this is one of the most iconic choruses for me from the 80s. This was released in July 1989, as a bunch of my songs were, from their debut album, Dirty, Rotten, Filthy, Stinking Rich.
Wow.
It's a mouthful, but I like it. This is Warrant's most successful single. I think that becomes, which is a trend for today, right, on these bands. It hit number 2 for 2 weeks on the U.S. Hot 100 and also number 4 in Norway. So Goa til Jobba. Out to our Norwegian friends.
Wow. Rob. Did you what did you just say?
Goa til Jobba.
What does that mean?
Good job.
I didn't know you could speak other languages.
I'm speaking a lot of languages. No. I try. I get out there.
Wow.
I've got Google, Google languages
Google
or whatnot.
Translate?
Yeah, that's good.
Oh, wow.
The video was shot during a live concert in Kansas City, Kansas. Not Missouri, folks, and checks every box for that time. Concert footage, acoustic guitars, backstage antics, girls singing and crying in the audience, hotel rooms, they're checking in, and my absolute favorite, simultaneous headbanging in slow motion on stage together. There was a shot of a group of what looked like rocker dudes with a sign that said, Warrant Rocks / is the best. Now, I don't know that they paid. I know they paid those guys because no group of rocker dudes ever made a sign that said Warrant is the best. So creep factor, yeah. Though, previously there's a line right before the first chorus where he says, as long as I'm the hero of this little girl. I'm on the record that I don't like to use the term little girl in any song, particularly a love song. I mean, was there nothing else to rhyme with in the 80s? Girl just sounds a little off-putting
maybe,
when grown men
maybe
are singing
he was-
it.
Maybe he wasn't writing about a grown woman. He's like it was a daughter or a, I don't know.
No, I know what the song's about. Yeah. I looked it up. It's about, a girl he loves. So I just don't, I mean, are they around the house be like, hey, girl, hey, little girl, come sit on my lap. I mean, it's gross.
Hey,
it just
little
sounds
girl,
gross.
Is your daddy home?
Well, he's bad too. So, but yeah, so that is my number two is Warrant. So
that felt higher than Love Bites for you.
It did.
Wow.
I know. And I like
you're
Love
number
Bites.
One.
It's out of this world. Great. So, well, Rob, before we rock out to our number one choices, let's head over to our favorite little place we like to call.
Yeah.
cut. And yeah. Oh, that guy's amazing.
So
well,
good.
We love music so much, it's literally impossible to choose just seven songs. So for this segment, that's a word, Rob and I will each identify two cuts that just missed being on our list, and an honorable mention that is a song we either didn't hear when it came out or have come to like even more as we've gotten older. In fact, maybe we just forgot about it. So with that, Rob, we're all waiting breathlessly for your first cut.
All right.
Oh, wow. I love this song.
I went to cut because it really doesn't good. For me hit as a ballad that you would automatically pick on your ballad. But
I got you. It's still good.
I like it.
I like when he walks around naked in the dark. Yeah. In the video. This is during the 90s when Axl was getting a little artistic with the videos.
His videos are weird.
You know, one of the background singers is the lead singer of Blind Melon.
That's in my notes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
Stole it.
Yeah.
But yeah, in fact, in the video, he's on top of the building with them.
On the helipad.
Yeah.
So this is 91, Don't Cry from Use Your Illusion 1. There's another version on Use Your Illusion 2. It's referred to as a power ballad. Peaked at number 10 on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100. Rose is quoted as saying, "The song was about a girl that Izzy had gone out with, and I was really attracted to her, and they split up. I was sitting outside the Roxy, and I was really in love with this person, and she was realizing this wasn't going to work. She wanted to do other things, and she was telling me goodbye, and I sat down and just started to cry. And she was telling me, don't cry. The next night, we got together and wrote the song in 5 minutes.
Ah, the inspiration.
In a later interview, he added, I went over to Izzy's and threw some rocks at his window. He came to the window, and I was worried I came over there, or he was worried I was coming over there to kick his ass. We'd been in an argument for a few months. It was like the Blues Brothers. We got to get the band back together. We sat down, and I was like, hey, I got some really depressing lyrics. He was like, I got a really depressing guitar part. I was like, perfect. We got it made. There you go. Don't Cry features Shannon Hoon of Blind Melon. As a co-lead vocalist, Hoon sings an octave higher than Rose.
Yes.
And his voice is placed further back in the mix. Hoon also appears in the music video singing alongside Rose during the helipad scenes.
I like the helipad scene.
Guns N' Roses tried recording this for their first album, 1987's Appetite for Destruction, but it didn't work. They didn't have Shannon. Yeah.
That's right.
Lyrics, give me a whisper and give me a sigh. Give me a kiss before you tell me goodbye. Don't you take it so hard now, and please don't take it so bad. I'll be thinking of you and the times we had, baby.
Nice.
Look at that.
That's good.
Anyway, that's my a good cut. First cut.
Yeah, that's very good. Don't have that. Hey. So far, we just have the one.
Just the one.
Going in so far, but we'll see. It's getting close now.
Yeah,
folks.
I know. We're getting
out. We won't hit the five, though. I was way above that.
Not even close.
All right, well, my first cut comes from one of probably the most popular and famous hair bands of the 1980s.
Oh, I don't have it.
Oh, nice. These five words.
Actually, that's six words. It's four words and a contraction.
All right. Here comes the educator, folks. So far today we've talked about what was it? What did you just said?
What?
A contraction. And we talked about I before E except after C. So in case you wanted an English lesson today, folks, we've brought it to you live.
I will be there for you. That's sick.
All right. So this is I'll Be There For You by Bon Jovi. When most people think of Bon Jovi ballad, they might want to go to Wanted Dead or Alive. However, this one is just more memorable for me because junior high, it was really big. And it's the one I think of when I think of a Bon Jovi ballad. And Wanted Dead or Alive seems a little more rocking, although they classify it as a ballad. So this was released as their third single off the New Jersey album in February of 89. This song hit number one on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100, number one on the U.S. Cashbox Top 100, mild success everywhere else, doing its best in Canada at number two and Ireland at number six. And what has become part of the formula for these ballads, the video starts in an empty stadium, then in the middle switches to concert footage shot at Wembley Arena in London, and of course opens with an acoustic guitar silently on stage, just John Bon Jovi wheeling away on that thing. And the emotion and the passion the girls in the audience have while singing is quite something to watch. Go watch the video, folks. Those girls are going to pass out. They're like, oh, my God, it's John and Richie. Classic ballad. Not as good as the others I've listed, but worth being a cut.
Yeah.
Oh, and in case you're wondering, the word girl also comes up in this song, too.
Oh, yeah. So, hey, girl.
There's definitely a girl in there. They don't go little girl. But they should say girl. I still think girl's not a great term, but that's fine. I just never called anyone girl. I don't remember doing that.
Hey, girl. So.
But yeah, Bon Jovi.
All right. Hey, I like it. My cut number two.
Cut number two.
Oh, we're getting early.
Oh, early.
Early in the 80s. Okay, so this is 1980.
Mm,
yeah,
wow.
Yeah.
There was a Power Ballad in 1980?
Yes, and you will agree.
I love it from the beginning.
Right?
I thought about this, but... You know, before there were hair bands, they had the hair.
I watched the video for this.
Yes.
Awful.
It's horrible. In fact,
they have said it's so horrible.
They said that they were told to film it real quick because MTV needed videos to put on. And then the lead singer said he called MTV and said, please don't play that video. And MTV is like, nope, we're doing it.
I thought I was watching, like, I found it and I started playing it. I was like, this is something else. Like, I thought I got the wrong thing. Where he's laying on the bed, he's laying on the, oh, no, the counseling. Yeah.
He said it's horrible.
And he's like, well, Doug, and it all started back. And I'm like, what am I watching?
Well, to be fair, what they said was it's 1980 and, you know, they're trying to put a video. Nobody knew what to do for a video. Nobody knew how to make a video.
No, it was bad.
So they were just like, let's just wing it and see what happens.
Yeah. So this is a rock ballad by REO Speedwagon. Mm-hmm. Keep on Loving You, performed by American Man. We talked about it. It was the first REO Speedwagon single to break the top 50 on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100. It reached number one.
Uh-huh.
Certified platinum.
It is.
It has been a mainstay on 1980s soft rock compilations. We go back to soft rock with the...
Love it.
Yeah. Ultimate classic rock rated at REO Speedwagon's all-time greatest song. Kevin Cronin, who's the lead singer, stated that he wrote Keep On Loving You as a more traditional love ballad, and the band as a whole developed it into its final arrangement as a power ballad. The story goes that lead singer Kevin Cronin played the song on the piano during a rehearsal. The band didn't like it. He said, dude, this is a quote, dude. This song really means a lot to me. And they said, so, dude, that's not an REO Speedwagon song. And I kind of was like, you know what? Dude. I'm the main songwriter for REO Speedwagon. So if I write a song, it's an REO Speedwagon song. It's the band's job to turn it into an REO Speedwagon song, unquote. The song is lead singer Kevin Cronin's response after he found out his wife Denise had been cheating on him before they were married. Instead of leaving her, he decided that he would keep on loving her no matter what as he made that promise.
That little quote section you had is like the equivalent of a rock band catfight.
Yeah, yeah. Like so, I said, like and no then, man, and like, then he said, and yeah. I was like, when I said that I loved you, I meant that I loved you forever.
Forever.
And I'm going to keep on loving you.
That's right.
Cronin called it, quote, the most painful song I ever wrote.
Ever wrote. Unquote. I still like it.
There you go.
So, well, that's great. Man, you are on fire. I have not disliked one song today.
Nice.
So, well, my second cut, probably the most dramatic sounding of all my songs. But still effective and somewhat memorable.
I don't have it.
That's good.
I don't know.
You don't know it. You'll know it in about 2 seconds.
But I don't know the band.
Oh, well, I'm going to enlighten you shortly. A lot of piano in this song. Did you figure it out yet?
No.
No?
I don't know it.
All right. Well, Kip is back, and not our producer in the booth, but the singer.
Winger.
His parents named him after from Winger.
Winger.
Kip is here with his perfect teeth and perfect jawline to serenade all the screaming ladies out there. This song only went to number 19 on the U.S. Hot 100, and by the way, it is headed for a heartbreak by Winger. It hit. It's a top 20 hit, but not the same success as some of the others I've mentioned. Kip said he was fooling around one day and just came up with the riff magically. I'm calling BS here. By 88, 89, every glam rock band and their label knew the formula, so I have no doubt Winger was told to put a ballad out like everybody else.
And I call BS too because when we did She's Only 17.
Yes.
He had some lame excuse for how that it wasn't about that or
something. I think it's
I didn't know that it was illegal.
I think it's formulaic. Like,
you did.
He thinks
you
he's...
You clearly did.
I think he thinks he's a better rocker than he really is. So Kip's claim that the riff came to him by accident seems like nonsense, but he says the song exemplifies the band the most of all their music. For the video, guess some of the themes, Rob. Give me a couple. What do you think happens?
There's a breakup.
There's no breakup. No girl in the video. Yeah. So
No breakup in the video?
No breakup.
They're apart.
We got some some tropes. So some tropes are they're on an empty stage.
Oh, is there
there's some simultaneous headbanging.
Empty hallway?
There's a guy playing a one-handed piano. There's no hallways. They're just in one thing. There's some wind.
Okay.
The wind is blowing the hair. So so those are some of those tropes.
Is there a lonely road?
There's no roads. They stay on the same set the whole time. There are some like sheets or curtains blowing in the wind as
lots
well.
Lots of flowing, yeah.
The song is about a man who wants to be left alone and move on with his life as his love has become a stranger to him.
Oh.
Despite that, he's going to be heartbroken. He chooses to live again instead of keeping on dealing with the pain she's causing him. The song is probably the most generic sounding and least memorable on my list, but it's worth being a cut because I remember it from being a kid.
Yeah.
But it's not my first go-to ballad. So.
Wow. Okay. Well, my honorable mention has a lot of the same elements that you just described.
Oh.
Where you're like, it's the least sounding. Like. Anyway, so here we go. It is?
Oh, wow. Is this Foreigner?
It is.
Wow. See, this is less ballad for me, more like soft rock.
Yeah.
That's why
it's at the honorable mention. It's listed as a power ballad.
I gotcha.
But I kind of disagreed with that.
I can see a little power ballady to it.
It really got its legs on the hot adult contemporary.
Of course it did.
So there you go.
This is another elevator dentist office song.
Yeah.
But it's a power ballad. Yeah. I'll give it ballad status. I'll say ballad status. Maybe not power ballad for me, but still seems more soft rocky than power ballady.
True.
I'll take it.
So this is I Want to Know What Love Is, Foreigner, 1984. They're a British-American rock band. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
The group's biggest hit to date. Ranked as the #4 Billboard Hot 100 single of 1985, the song knocked Madonna's long-running Like a Virgin out of #1 on the Billboard Hot 100 on February 2nd of 85.
My goodness.
Here's a crazy thing. It is charted on the top 25 in 2000, 2001, and 2002 on the Billboard Hot Adult Contemporary Recurrence chart. Listed as one of Rolling Stone's magazine's greatest songs of all time at #476.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was in 2004. And then in 2010, it got knocked down a few spots to 479.
Still hanging in.
It's been covered by Mariah Carey, Winona Judd, Kenny Chesney. The New Jersey.
That was a weird group to cover that song.
I know.
Okay.
The New Jersey Mass Choir was brought in to sing the backing vocals, becoming the first gospel choir to appear on a #1 pop hit.
Nice.
It's been described as a highly dramatic and ultimately very touching song, which amply displays Foreigner's musical talents and versatility.
Wow.
There you go. It's dreamy, hypnotic, soulful. There you go.
There you go. So
that's my.
It's good. My Foreigner.
Mention. Yeah, it didn't quite fit, but that's why.
No, it fits. I mean, it's still a ballad. Yeah. It's kind of on the same lines as me as like Journey's Open Arms.
Yeah. Yep.
Kind of on the same. Yep. Still considered a ballad.
I just think as the totality of this whole playlist,
this
it plays well.
Oh, it does. So, I think my honorable mention is going to surprise you a little bit. So, this is a.
I really want to know your number.
This
one
is a song by a group I really like, but not the song I listen to the most when I listen to their '80s stuff because I really love their '80s stuff. But this is never the first song I go to. But as I've listened to it getting ready for the show, I really like it. So maybe I should include it more often.
I saw him on there and I thought he's going to do a heart song.
It's good. Ann Wilson's voice. Amazing.
My principal just went and saw them.
Wow. Nice.
Went and saw Heart at Safeco. Not Safeco anymore. T-Mobile.
Here we go. I like when Nancy kicks in. There she is. She does it one more time, I think.
Never. That's good. Oh, she gets mad.
Oh, it's
good.
Screaming. Great. So this is Never by Heart. It's not only the bad boys of rock that can turn out a great ballad. This one's for the ladies. In fact, Heart had several great ballads in the 80s and early 90s. This came out August 29th, 1985, off of their 8th studio album, titled Heart. This is a rock song with an uplifting lyric to a person who has been discouraged by love. It hit #4 on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100, #2 on the U.S. mainstream rock charts, and was the 18th best-selling single of 1986. I just really love Heart in the 80s. I can't get enough of their ballads in the 80s. And Ann Wilson is just a great singer. She sounds fantastic. Yeah. Unfortunately, in the music video, they focus mainly on Nancy Wilson, as she was deemed more photogenic than Ann, despite Ann singing the majority of the song. I think it's been mentioned before, but it's pretty terrible. They dress Ann in a lot of black, as it was deemed slimming. And I saw an interview where Ann and Nancy said they were following MTV and the video directors, but looking back, they compromised way too much and should have demanded to do the videos the way that they wanted to. Mm-hmm. I watched this video, and they're definitely not subtle. Nancy's in a low-cut shirt, very, sexy looking. Yeah. And she gets full-body shots on camera, whereas Ann is, like, they shoot her from a distance. Oh. She's shoulders up. Sometimes her face, it's just her face.
Yeah.
And then one time she's literally in the shadows, and all you see is one eyeball singing. So it is. But I will say, Nancy on lead guitar, she's doing one-legged kicks like they are going out of style. I mean, she could have been a rockette for the, rock music city. She's kicking left and right. I'm surprised the other guys didn't get whacked. It was like watching Bloodsport. Frank Dukes eat his heart out on that one. So
I had read somewhere that
they had a falling out. There's a whole bunch of heart stuff you can go find.
Yeah. Well, and she and kind of went. They became a recluse, abuse, but she fell off because
she had a lot of image issues. Yeah, image issues. Yeah. So she had a lot of substance abuse. She's clean now, but she was drinking. She was doing a lot of other things. Yeah. And they didn't put her front and center and all these other things. So, the reason it's my honorable mention is because I listen to Alone. I listen to these dreams. I listen to these songs, but Never seems to be one I kind of just don't get to very often.
Yeah.
But I really love that chorus.
It's good.
I like it. I'll spend a little more time with it. So. Well, that takes you to the long-awaited number one.
My number one.
And my number one hasn't been played.
Mine has.
We'll see. Oh, well, then there we go. So we don't have the same number one after all.
We don't have the same number one.
But that's only two crossovers.
And that's not bad.
Pretty good.
All right. Here we go.
Ah. You thought this would be my number one?
I did.
Okay.
I did. I put it down. I was like, I could see him going with this.
I love it.
When it comes to 80s, 90s ballads.
I love it. It's absolutely fantastic.
Oh, I like it.
I kind of figured it was going to be number one when you got through your cuts and it hadn't shown up.
Yeah.
Because I didn't think you were going to leave Love Bites off.
No, you can't. But anyway, this is Love Bites. We talked about it's Def Leppard, Hysteria. I found this quote and I really liked it. It was the lead, a subtitle for an article. And it said, the Jay Giles Band told us in 1980 that love stinks, but Def Leppard reminds us that love bites.
Very good.
Very good.
That guy won like a prize for that.
Great writing on that one. Def Leppard's only number one single on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100. In 2015, Classic Rock Magazine ranked it as ninth on their top 40 greatest power ballad list. You talked about it being a country ballad, considered a classic of the genre.
It is.
Lots of questions in the song. When you make love, do you look in the mirror? We talked about that. Who do you think of? Does he look like me?
That's a weird question.
I know. When I'm with you, are you somewhere else?
Yeah.
And then kind of a risque question. Am I getting through or do you please yourself?
I like that part actually. So. Can you imagine being 12 years old? You're just wailing that part?
Yeah.
Or do you please yourself?
I don't understand. What does he mean?
I think we knew at 12, but that's okay.
I don't want to touch you too much, baby, because making love to you might drive me crazy. And here's what we've learned about love from this song. Love bites.
Love beats.
Love bleeds.
Bleeds, that's right.
Love brings me to my knees. Love lives. Love dies. Love begs. And love pleads.
It's like Shakespeare right there.
Wow. Yeah.
Don't you think?
Shakespeare.
It's really good. So, all right. Well, you don't have my number one?
No.
Drastically different. Wow. My number one shows that even the most hardcore partying band of the 80s can ease off the gas just a little bit.
Did I mention it?
We started with Motley Crue. We're ending with Motley Crue.
Okay, I'm really pissed at myself. It's not even, I didn't even remember this one.
Wow.
It's not even on my.
This is just one of the best.
That is an epic fail.
Listen to this guitar. Nikki Sixx right there.
Yeah. Oh, no, I have it on here. Home Sweet Home.
There you go. You found it.
Right here. Yep.
Mm. Do you hear this?
Right in between Angel, huh? Aerosmith, and Carrie from Europe.
That's a bad one. Oh, we let this one go for a while, didn't we?
I love it.
We're in it.
Let it. It's all right. It's our show.
That's going to go way deep into that guitar solo. All right. Well, this is Home Sweet Home by Motley Crue. When I started working on this topic for this episode, I wrote this song down before I looked at anything else. I put number one next to it, and then I figured out the rest of the list. I absolutely love this song, ballad or not. It's just one of my favorite songs of the 80s. The video is super silly, as it shows the band at the beginning doing a variety of weird things like scuba diving, partying. There's a haunted house. And then they each get a call. And then as soon as they pick up the phone, they're just like, I'm on my way. And that's how the video starts, right? It's pretty cheesy. But the payoff is tour bus, concert footage, and everything all the other bands, in my opinion, copied later. As this was released in 1985. Uh-huh. This only hit number 89 in the U.S. Hot 100, but I think had it been released later in the 80s, could have been a number one or at least top 10 hit. Mm-hmm. It was re-released in 1991, but only hit number 37. But again, probably missed that sweet spot of 87 to 89. Yeah. The song ranks number 12 on VH1's list of greatest power ballads. However, I question the validity of that list, as Kiss, Creed, and Metallica are all ranked over them. Mm. They might have good ballads, but not like this, in my opinion. It is acknowledged that hair bands of the late 80s emulated the sound and video stylings of this song because it became so lucrative. It's my favorite rock ballad of all time. It spurs memories of being a kid. And unlike when I joke about using these types of songs for weddings and other big events, I'm serious when I say I would have loved to have this play at my wedding reception. But my beautiful wife, who I love very much, would have said something like, we're not getting married in the late 1980s. So alas, we had jazz and proper music for the event. I'm pretty sure that conversation would have been me saying, hey, can I ask the DJ to play Motley? And before I even finished, she would have said no and walked out of the room. So it's not a rock concert. It's our wedding. So.
We've mentioned that before, that there was another song. I don't know.
My Chicago song.
Yeah, that's what I was
Or it's Peter Cetera, Glory of Love.
Yeah.
And that was another one that got rejected. No. So,
well, when you guys renew your vows, it's your turn.
But I can just hear, it's not a rock concert. It's our wedding. All right. I don't want people to think back and think about Motley Crue. Oh, all right, Van Morrison it is. All so right. That's fine.
Okay.
So. But number one, Home Sweet Home.
That's a good list.
Great. I think we have great. That's great songs from top to bottom. That playlist is perfect for all of you out there headed toward Valentine's Day. For all you rockers, non-rockers, again, put this on, and we already explained what's going to happen.
Yeah.
So that'll make your day, I promise. Yeah.
There'll be draws.
Draws flying left and right. You know, you'll feel like you're John Bon Jovi or Sebastian Bach and just bras getting tossed at you, right? So that's what's going to happen. So.
All right.
But I think it's a great list. So, if you'd like to contact Rob and I, which we always look forward to, you can find us on all the social media sites, Facebook, X, Instagram. We're on YouTube. We look great if you want to come see us over there. If not, that's fine too. We provided links for all those places in the show notes. And you can also just Google Totally 80s and 90s Recall anywhere on the interwebs. You'll find us. We pop up all over the place.
That's right. And if you can also find us at our website at Totally 80s 90s Recall at podbean.com. And finally, feel free to email us at 80s90srecall@gmail.com. We do read our email.
We do. I love getting emails.
Where you can ask questions about current or previous episodes, suggest future show ideas, or simply say hello. We look forward to hearing from all of our listeners worldwide.
Worldwide, because we do have some around the world.
We do.
And finally, we have a merchandise store. It's on our show notes. We're not making any money off this, folks. We just think it's fun to put some shirts together. Yeah. We got some plums. We got some No Fancy Goodbyes. Mm-hmm. We're working on a Robster shirt. Mm-hmm. So if you just want to have something fun to wear, you'll be the envy of your friends. It's funny. It's, it's no big deal. And again, we're not going to become wealthy millionaires over the night on t-shirt sales. We just thought it'd be cool to put something up and have some people enjoy repping Totally 80s, 90s Recall.
We also have, there's some very nice coffee mugs.
Coffee mugs.
So if you're not into the wearing of the
That's right.
The apparel.
Coffee mug. You could be at the water cooler at work and you'd be like, hey, Joe.
That's right.
What's that mug you got there? Oh, that's Totally 80s, 90s Recall.
Say, Joe.
Hey, Joe. Are they 1920s gangsters? Hey, Joe, what you got there? I got a mug, see?
Why did I get so mean, Vinny?
that mutated fast. That all right, bad. So.
I got a closing thought.
Closing thought?
All right. So this is a quote. Around the mid-90s, every hair guy who would have been in a hair metal band got his tattoos, and suddenly decided he was alternative.
Oh, yeah.
It just became like a thing, unquote. And that's Billy Corgan
from
the Smashing Pumpkins.
Well, he's a little of a weirdo sometimes.
It is, so. but I put a little note. I said, we make fun of hair metal.
No.
But we can't ignore hair metal's place in the lineage of grunge music.
I don't make fun of hair metal. I love it. I just think it's fun. Look, music's not like that anymore. And I'm not trying to be the old guy on the porch.
No.
But just thoughtless kind of songs that are fun to sing along with. You rock out. You don't think about it. You just turn it up and have a good time. Yeah. And, you know, that's fine. And Billy Corgan, look, let's give people credit. They evolved. They liked rock music. Yeah. So as rock music changed, they changed with rock music and they start to like other things. Yeah.
So that's why I think I appreciate the hair metal genre.
I like it. You're never going to convince me it's bad.
No, because I think I see the lineage of see a lot. You know, you look at Alice in Chains, who at one point, if you look at their history, they were a glam band. They were kind of that middle. Anyway,
You can read a Kurt Cobain book where in the mid '80s he was also trying to start a band, you know, and then he got more into punk, but at first it was what was popular.
Absolutely.
So it was those things. So
I think we need to honor it for what it was.
Yes. I just think it's fun. I love listening to it. It's great. You put some of these songs on and you just, you know, cry in the car. Have a great time. So.
Well, you're Axl Rose crying on the sidewalk. Oh. Don't cry.
Or naked in his little, again, that video's weird.
The image of Axl Rose sitting on the sidewalk and somebody rubbing his back going, don't cry.
Don't cry.
It's all right, Axl.
It's okay.
Oh, my gosh.
You're dating a supermodel. You're rich. What's the problems here, right? So, well, that brings us to the end of this heartfelt episode. We hope you've enjoyed our look back at our favorite 80s power ballads. And who knows, maybe this playlist will be the soundtrack for your Valentine's Day celebration this year. I highly recommend it should be. If you like today's musical choices, because of course you would, we provided links to Spotify, Apple, and Amazon playlists in the show notes so you can experience all of these songs in full as we only play parts of them. Finally, as always, we'd like to truly thank all of our listeners, whether first-timers or subscribers, for hanging out with Rob and I. Hopefully, we gave you an hour or so with some laughs. And don't forget to tune in for all new episodes. Totally 80s and 90s Recall every Tuesday.
Every Tuesday.
That is right.
What in the heck are we doing for next time?
All right. Your homework is part two. This was part one of our Valentine's Day specials. I can't say Valentine's Day. I keep moving that together. I've said Valentine's twice.
That's all right.
I don't think that's a word.
That's okay.
Part two of our Valentine's Day specials. And we're going to cover love songs of the 1990s. Oh. Volume 2.
Okay, 1990s Volume 2?
Yes, 90s Volume 2. We did 80s hair metal today, or power ballads, if you were. So we're going to do some 90s love songs, and it's a Volume 2 because last year we did a called mini episode.
Yeah.
And we did some 90s love songs. There were only 10 songs. It's only like a 20-minute episode. But there's some cool songs you can go back and listen to.
Was that our virtual episode?
Yes, it was.
It was the one, the only one that we've done
virtual
apart.
And the audio is not perfect. That's so, all right. But if you want to hear what we played before, and then on the next episode, you'll hear what we've got, and then you'll have a good array of love songs from the 1990s.
I love it.
All right. Well, you got anything else?
I don't have anything else.
Fancy goodbye.
No fancy goodbyes.
Boom. I'm impressed we only had two. I thought for sure we'd have a lot more crossovers than that.
That's a great list.
Certified panty droppers. I'll be